Hello, my good brothers and sisters. This is Minister Edward J. Robin speaking to you from Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, on the second day of 2020, our new decade of focus and vision. So I've come here today to, first of all, give credit to the founder of the Constitution Club, Keith Broders, an amazingly resilient man of research and dedicated mind, heart, and soul. I want to give special commendation to Keith for his long service in trying to provide a method, a forum, a central place where men and women nationwide could come together to voice their opinions and learn about their discoveries and share about the revelations that they've come across and the thoughts that have come into their mind and their discoveries of how to come out of Babylon. And that's what this is going to be pretty much about here today, coming out of Babylon, and why the founders of America decided they needed some paper, decided they were going to use the word Constitution. I'm going to try and elucidate, put down a few facts. Myself, I'm an ardent researcher, student of the Bible, and of secular law. I've been at it for 25 years. I took up my faith as a prodigal son, coming back and being rediscovered in a miracle of events I won't attend to here, but it was that miracle that caused me to go into a deeper research as to what the world believed, why they believed it, and if we were following the path Christ intended. That was my motivation and is indeed my motivation for speaking to you here today. Turn this off. So, I'd like to start with the fact that all of us are aware of codes, statutes, regulations, laws, or rules, whatever we want to call them. We're all aware of that. We had them when we were children. Our parents got upset if we threw food on the floor or the wall. And so eventually we started to know there were certain rules that were frowned upon and that we couldn't get away with, you know, be back at home before midnight, you know, those kind of things. So today we're all here, Constitution Club, because we don't like the effect that those rules have upon the people that are put in place of administering those rules. Power corrupts. Absolute power absolutely corrupts. So when one observes that axiom, that rule, it's been around for a long time. I forget, it's only been observed in the last century as a coined phrase. But nonetheless, when you observe these centuries of that being in place, it's very, very important to observe who's writing the rules. And whether or not they understand the principles of love, do not harm your brothers and sisters, as the main coordinating factor for any group of civilized men and women to maintain their freedoms and their liberties. Without that as the core element, the freedoms and the liberties divest into privileges and licenses. And that's what we've taken place here today, where we lost our position granted with the scripture of only having to understand two laws. Love your Creator with all your heart and spirit, and love your brothers and sisters as yourself. Now, those two laws don't make a lot of money for anybody, at least if they're involved in the business of courts and lawyers and accounting and insurance and licensing and regulation and statutes and codes and law professors and law universities. And they all make a living off of creating rules on paper. Rules are that are in excess of and derogatory to the Bible. Now, I'm going to mention that Bible is a set of rules on paper because it has not been subscribed to men. It has been subscribed to being created by God. And without going into a debate about that, for the nature of this conversation, we're going to accept God as the supreme deity that makes the rules. We're just the fools that break them. We get that as a central factor in our discussion or in this dialogue dissertation of mine, it's much easier to understand why we must maintain the respect for one another in a civilized group of men and women. There must be that type of written on the heart type of law so that we know it. And this is why the Bible was put in place, with all of these rules being subscribed to God as the creator of those rules. Nobody gets to add to them or take away from them. That's Deuteronomy 4:2, Deuteronomy 12:32. So when the founders of the United States, trying to escape the control of the British monarchy, slavery, they too being officers of that monarchy, some of them, esquires, committed a treason against the people to maintain the power of the British crown. And had they been put in place to maintain your freedom, you would never have seen that word constitution. You would have been told what it meant, at least, as it relates to the word constitutor. Now, the constitutor is one who, by a simple agreement, promises to pay the debt of another. Now, that's just as basic as it gets. There's nothing complicated about it. That's what it is. He promised to pay the debt of another. So if you're a constitutor, there's a set of rules. If the debtor is in debt, well, then the rules of the creditor are going to apply. And indeed, that's exactly what takes place when you look at a constitution. A constitution is a set of rules for the debtors. It offers these so-called rights and freedoms. It talks a lot about the rights and only gives you a little smattering about the freedoms. Freedoms is the important word to latch onto because those are inherent. You were born with them. Rights, on the other hand, are something that men have created artfully, deceptively, using the pulpit and a false interpretation of Romans 13 to get you to submit to. They're thinking that you never read Deuteronomy 4:2, 12:32, where God said, don't add to my law, don't take away from my law. And they're figuring you probably never read Leviticus 18, 3 through 4, where God said, hey, I brought you out of Egypt where all those false gods. Don't you be going walking in the ordinance of the heathen. He warned them. He said, what are you doing with that for? He took you out of there. So another strong hint in the scriptures so as to expose why they use the word constitution as a set of rules for all the constitutors is the word person. That word person is so much part of our communication to each other that it's practically a minute doesn't go by than one of us is using it in a sentence relative to ourself or somebody else that we're talking about. It's been a generic term that has been used without study as to what it means. It comes from the Latin persona, two syllables, words there, per, with, or by, and sona, which is sound, by sound. So in the Greek amphitheaters of past, they used to wear masks, and they had little funnels coming out of where the mouth was. And the masks were quite large, so that the people in the audience could see who the fictitious character was that these people were playing on the stage. That little piece throwing the sound was which came about with the name persona. The mask became known as an instrument on the stage to not only identify who the character was, but to throw the sound so that the actor was not hoarse by the end of the play from screaming his lines so that everybody in the amphitheater could hear him. So that word person has been demonstrably used in every statute, code, and regulation of the corporate United States and all of the inherent states that are underneath it, sub-registered in league with the United States, not being the United States of America, lowercase on United, lowercase on S. United States of America, capital A on America. So before those states became corporations, persons of law, they had a lowercase s. As soon as they became corporate entities, just like in Canada, our lowercase p provinces, is a landmass. As soon as it gets a uppercase P on it, it's a franchise province. It's a trick. They make the province, the word that normally would be a small case, into a corporation by putting a capital P on it. That's the way they've done it with states. United States. There's no United States of America. The United States is the corporation that took over in, I think it was 1781. So at any rate, aside from a history lesson, which I'm sure we're all of us have quite a bit of knowledge on, the main history is to recognize that God gave his son to come down and say, hey, I'm washing away all that statute, code, and regulation that these guys created to own you, enslave you, bone you with their paper knives. I'm washing it away. Well, if you can imagine here, these people who were granted free labor in Leviticus chapter 25, and I hope some of you are reading with me to catch on to the severity of this fraud. Leviticus chapter 25, 44 through 50, God is directing the Israelites fresh out of Egypt. Well, maybe not fresh, but they coming out of Egypt, who had brought a bunch of Ammonites with them and another bunch of people come out of Egypt that were pretty much rejected by the Pharaoh. The Ammonites were the people that worshipped Amen, the false god of Egypt. His name was Amen. Interestingly enough, that's another story. We can get into that another time. But they had left Egypt, and they weren't worshiping Yahuwah, the Hebrew God. And so they became thieving around the edge of the camp, and they were eating scavenged leftover food and stuff and getting sick. So it was directed, go purchase them, make them your possessions, to give them to your children for an inheritance, so they shall be your possessions forever. Now this is God directing the Israelites, the Levites, everybody to take note. You guys got free labor from now on forever, because I say so. These guys won't follow my law. Make them slaves. Make them possessions. That's right there. Now, God giving free labor. Go read the text very carefully and see where God took it away and where they gave it up. Because those two factors must be coordinate with one another, that they understand that they don't get that free labor anymore. Well, it turns out the Israelites, Hebrews, Jews, whatever we wish to call them so it's accurately combined, connected with history, they got divorced by God. They were off adulterating with false gods, and he called them on their adulteration. And he divorced them. Said, that's it. You're not my people anymore. It's over. Done. It's finished. Now, a lot of people don't like to accept that, especially if they're Jewish heritage. You know, who's going to give up your free labor easily? And this is why they reacted so violently to when Christ came along. He came to free everybody. He came to take away that false law of enslavement. And they knew it. They knew what he represented. And they didn't like the fact that God had divorced them. And they rejected him like spoiled little children. Decided to take his son and put him to death, so they could defeat having their free labor removed. Didn't work out too good though. His blood put in place a freedom, a redemption seal that's never going to go away for anybody that claims it or knows enough how to read Romans 13, which is the censure. You know, a lot of you may be listening to me making all sense, but eventually somebody's going to bring up Romans 13. Oh, yes. That's the hammer. Oh, we're supposed to submit ourselves to these false god governments. It says right there, Romans 13, submit yourself to the minister. It says it three times. So that's good. Thank you for bringing that scripture up. Let's have a look at that. The connotation of that chapter is we are to submit to ministers. That's the word right there. Go check it out. Three times for emphasis. God's ministers. So let's go look it up and see if the governments of today are God's ministers when we read Ezra chapter 7, 23 through 26. Because certainly we couldn't have Christ directing us to submit to false gods. We couldn't have Paul directing us to submit to false gods. So let's examine what Paul was talking about when he mentioned the word minister, because it cannot change in that Bible, and yet the whole of Christendom for 17 centuries had been lied to from the pulpit, telling you, submit to the false god authorities, make up law, add to his law, take away from his law, rape and pillage those who would even talk about standing up for their faith, and intimidate others. And that's what's been going on. We've been lied to. When you read Ezra chapter 7, the connotation of the word minister means they must be of God's temple. They must be adjudicating with God's law. They cannot be paying taxes. No, that's a no-no. And they must be teaching them that don't know God's law all about it. That's the witnessing. That's the sign of a minister that we are to submit to in Romans 13. Not some false god that's added to God's law, taken away from God's law, and is a trading entity on the stock exchange, using your body listed as a surety and put up as a security on a piece of paper giving evidence of the fact that your body has been used to set up a whole life policy collecting 12.3% per annum annuities on that bond of $8 million in Canada. I think it's $10 million in the United States. And you can find that in the Corporations Act of Delaware. I can't remember the exact number, but it's the Corporations Act in Delaware, and you'll find that the bonding number figure that's used there for each entity coming into as a corporate entity in the United States is $10 million you're bonded for. That's collecting annuities. It's like a whole life policy. The whole of the United States since 1933 and Canada have been operating under that same principle, because the Jewish bankers that were running and orchestrating the stock exchange's fall in 1929, they knew that they could radically come in and take away all the nation's gold if they did this. And indeed they did. April 10th, 1933 in Canada, the Section 3 of the Dominion Notes Act was seized and taken out of power. So from that point on, there was no gold to give value to the paper money in Canada, whereas prior, just like in the United States, identical, the gold had been written into law as to giving money its effective value. Well, after that, the politician said, what are we supposed to do to give value to the money? And the banker said, set up a registry and register all the men, women, and children and put a whole life policy on their heads, bond them for $8 million in Canada, $10 million. In the United States, and put it's 12.3% per annum in Canada, annuities on this policy, with the government as the one collecting and administering the management of the annuity funds, which are in the trillions of dollars, hundreds of trillions of dollars. So I wanted everybody to understand that the use of that word constitution and any of the statute codes and regulations that are underneath that constitution, created by the power of that constitution, is like using creative copulation with a dead prostitute to gain virginity. That's not speculation. That's not an opinion. That's a reality, scripturally founded, that if you use any other law other than God's law, you're in bed with a dead false god. That's necrophilia. There's one living creator that you're supposed to have a relationship with. You are married to your creator. And as soon as you start having a relationship with another so-called de facto authority, a false god, that's adultery. You violated your marriage contract with your creator. And as such, we've all been suffering. Now, Christ come along to free us from that Babylonian Talmud, because when he was talking about, get out of her, my people, Babylon the Great is fallen. He wasn't talking about a city that had passed on 500 years earlier. He was talking about the great law of Babylon, the Talmud. That's the one where they were owning and boning people with paper. That's the one. So when you understand that, and he said, his blood freed you, And nowadays, all of their laws worldwide, so as the guys writing the laws, the Jewish banker and underwriter for the insurance companies, well, he doesn't want to lose his place in line to be able to claim his faith and belief in God, is you can't discriminate against me. So he wrote it in there, and it covers everybody. Everybody's faith and beliefs is immune from discrimination. But only if you're wise enough to know how to take away the assumption that you're a person. If you don't spend a good amount of time taking away that assumption, the whole system is geared from the time you're registered at birth to believe and act upon the fact that you're a person. They believe it to be a fact. So if you didn't know about it all your life, it's impossible for you to change that contractual assumption. They have that social binding contract they have with you upon the registration to ensure that you're taken care of and looked after. They act as a trustee. Under that constitution, they bind themselves to ensure that you, listed as a surety, a valuable collateral, shall not be damaged so as to put a risk upon the value of the estate that they have trust over and control over and they're making money off of. So they have a duty to ensure your physical body, your well-being, is not harmed so that they would lose their surety. That's risk management. So that's where they have police officers, courts, jails, hospitals to take care of your body. Should your body show that it's running a risk by breaking any of the statute codes or regulations that are put in place to ensure that everything works smoothly within their system to their benefit, well, then they're going to come and grab you, and they use you as a surety by consent because you submit to being the person. You have no idea that the Bible says, he made you the head. Well, if you're the head, when these dead fictional entities come with badges and guns, you're only to ask questions. 100% of the time, never once are you to submit an answer to them. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. Well, if you're asking questions, as it turns out grammatically, you're not saying anything, but you are exerting authority, for it is the one who is asking the question that will remain the head. So I wanted to share this with you and give credit to Keith in his efforts to bring people closer to the facts, while at the same time demonstrating there is a constitution in place. There's two offers. One is the dead, cursed law of man that has shown evidentially through the centuries its cursings upon mankind. And then there's the living law of our Creator that He put in place, the blessing that He gave us, that He set before us, life and death, blessing and cursing. Choose life that thou may live. So as we can see, the laws of the Constitution, statute, code, and regulation, precedent, that's dead law. It's the prostitute beckoning. She's got her necklace on. She's all dressed up nice, puffed shoulders and a gown. You know, unfortunately, she's not too much into color. She's wearing the dead type of color, gravestone, black. Her figures, the names are printed in all capital letters. She's got your names printed in tombstone, all capital letters. She's a dead prostitute, and she's really good at what she does. She wants to provide her services, and her services are to put you in jail, put you in touch with the tax man, put you in bed with the doctor looking over you, close to dead, and maybe the undertaker eventually. It's to regulate, inspect, select, neglect, and just defect the whole of the population, knowing that they can use them as a bank. Just like the Matrix, we're like batteries, and we volunteered for it. And until a story like this comes along, very, very few people ever wake up in the Matrix. They believe the Romans 13 dialogue that they're supposed to submit to the ministers of the day that have a capital M on their title. If you go look around through your governments, wherever that word minister is used, if it is, you'll see there's a capital M on there. That's titular. That's a title, a noun, and that's personage. That's sinning. If you show respect to persons, you commit sin. So knowing these fine little details about the Bible, when he says in Deuteronomy 1:9-17, if you show respect to persons, you commit sin. And when he says the same thing in Deuteronomy 10:17, you sort of take up and go, oh, he doesn't respect persons. When he repeats it in Samuel 14:14, you're really starting to sit up and take notice. Wow, God doesn't like persons. And then when you hear what he says in Matthew 22:16, Acts 10:34, even Peter says, surely I perceive God is no respecter of persons. On again into Romans 2:11, God's no respecter of persons. And finally, we get to hear it in James, where James 2:9 says, if you should show respect to persons, you commit sin and shall be convinced of the law as a transgressor. So upon that knowledge, one word, the faith of mustard seed, and you asking questions, do you have the authority to intimidate me to violate my faith by respecting persons in contradiction to the scriptures that I follow and hold dear? Question mark. Ding. Do you get to intimidate me to violate my faith or tell me that because I'm asking questions, you're going to hold me in contempt? Question. Questions are the power, when one has the faith of a mustard seed, to believe that you cannot be intimidated for asking them. Is there any law, statute, code, regulation that allows you, as a servant of the public, providing a service here today, to intimidate me to do anything that I have a right to do, or prevent me from doing the thing I have a right to do, or intimidate me to do a thing I have a right not to do? Well, of course, the answer is no. They don't have that power and authority. Well, once you have the authority to stand in the biblical word and say, well, do you have the authority to drag me out of scripture here where I'm commanded by God not to submit to false gods or respect persons? They have to answer no. So you can start to see how the mask that they wear, that person, can be stripped off by asking questions. And I myself have had 7 judges disqualified using this process. It's not like I was malicious in there to disqualify anybody. But the purpose is, if you are brought before those dark forces in those courts that are secular, you best be the one asking the questions so they don't assume that you're in submission to them and you're showing respect to their personage. Because if you answer one of their questions, you're a sinner. You've respected persons, and now you've submitted yourself to statute, code, and regulation as a dumb goyim that didn't know any better. So I thought I would share that with you all here. Again, giving great credit to Keith, and hopefully as we come closer together in this focus of 2020, that optimal position that we have at this time to take God's numbers and his vision and his word and put them together collectively so we can bring the Constitution Club into an accurate focus regardless of the man or woman's faith and beliefs that's doing the reading. They can all agree, these are the facts, this is how it's operating, and this is the way those who set up the system have allowed us to come out, only by exercising faith in the manner so subscribed under international rule. So we don't have to make use of that rule. All we have to do is say, listen, we're here acting as the watchmen, we're emissaries, diplomats of faith, and we have a duty to warn you that these particular instruments you put in place may fall afoul of your lack of administration and failure to perform your duty in the manner so subscribed. Well, we're asking for you to perform your duty to accommodate our faith, which would simply mean you list this as do not apprehend, do not detain on your lists. Of course, if you have evidence we've harmed somebody or property, then it's a different matter. But with regards to the day-to-day statutory codes, regulations, and administration of such, we wish to effect an absolute absolvement from that, an immunity as reflected in your record. And we would ask you to demonstrate what hardship that this would bring you or anybody else by having a respect for our faith and belief to follow our Creator in His rule and our Lord Yahushua the Christ. If you have any reason to believe that us doing that would represent a threat or harm to anybody, we would please ask that you communicate upon which basis that you're assuming this. We look forward to hearing from you as soon as it may be practical for you to reply. Well, these kind of communications, and I'm just cuffing that. I don't memorize anything. It's just it comes. You need to say something, and you just say it. If these type of, I'll call them tactics, why is a serpent make his dove? If these type of tactics are relied upon by the men or women that wish to either start believing in Christ, have a closer look, and work with others who are going to unite and grow as a community, exercising faith in Christ can be, just like the Bible says, a sword of justice. you can finally not only clear a path to that meadow of freedom, but you can ward off any attacks quite effectively, hacking off the arms, legs, and even heads of those who may attack you with their words. These fictional entities carrying arms, legs, and heads are just that. They're fictional. There's nothing real, or no blood's going to flow when a fictional entity is severed. That severment is only a philosophical use of the words to make the men or women that are listening understand of the severe nature of severing your relationship with a dead prostitute. Once you understand, you're literally labeling yourself as a necrophiliac by being in bed with her once you know about it, and you continue to lie there, affecting orgasm after orgasm in this dead bed of the dead prostitute. Well, then it doesn't look very good as far as a relationship with the creator and those guys, the creditors, the Jews that run the World Bank, that are taught that this is what they believe and they're supposed to follow. And I'm not dissing them for what they believe. I'm just saying I believe, my opinion, is that they are in error. And that opinion, of course, is based upon the scripture and the words of Jesus Christ. So I would like all of you to have a closer look at your grasp of what constitution means, what constitutor means, and how you can help Keith bring more of the people that are part of the club's day-to-day activities into awareness of these so-called bits of information, these subtle facts, one regarding the person, the other the Romans 13 false interpretation, and the international covenants that put a binding obligation and a duty to accommodate upon every public servant or regulated industry providing a service to any men or women in the United States that happen to believe in Christ, that they are men and women, and they don't wish to participate in the dead corporate world. So the potential exists, but it is difficult to get men and women to act in union together, especially when they've had 17 centuries of false Romans 13 interpretation shoved down their throats and only just learned about it. It takes a while to come out of the dead bed and awaken to the flowers in the meadow, the wind blowing and the stream running. It's been alive the whole time. We've just been enticed, seduced into this bed of the dead and thinking that's where we're supposed to be. The smell should have been our first hint. But I think some of us have been trained to believe that's good, that smell of the dead. So I thank you all for taking the time to listen to me and probably do more reflections on information, knowledge sharing here in the future with you all. And I take great pleasure in the fact that Keith invited me to this and give great honor to his fortitude in putting this all together for us. So thank you all for your time and may God bless. Bye for now.